It is Thanksgiving Day that we're approaching, and I wonder if you are looking forward to Thanksgiving Day this year. I'm not exactly sure, but for most of us, there are thoughts probably about eating too much food, gathering with family and friends, maybe football. Thanksgiving has become a day off, a time to relax. But very often the namesake of the day is forgotten. It's Thanksgiving Day. So what are we thankful for? Well, Thanksgiving Day sermons wouldn't be Thanksgiving Day sermons without some Thanksgiving Day jokes. So I want to ask you, where does Christmas come before Thanksgiving? In the dictionary. Other acceptable answers are apparently Walmart and my house this year. If April showers bring May flowers, then what do May flowers bring? Pilgrims. And which side of the turkey has the most feathers? The outside. See, some of you have heard these before. These are not original, okay. What should you be thankful for this year? Well, you should be thankful that you're not a turkey. Although some of you are. How do you know which member of the band is the turkey, Dan? He's the one with the drumsticks. All right, on a serious note, for Christians, every day should be Thanksgiving Day. While the American celebration of Thanksgiving Day looks back to the time when the pilgrims sought a new world for religious freedom and economic opportunity, Christians take the holiday as an opportunity to reflect on all that we have to be thankful for. And so I do want to encourage you, as we're approaching Thanksgiving Day, to take some time, take a moment to reflect and actually give God thanks. If you celebrate with family or friends, take a moment and share what you're thankful for, and then offer your thanks before God, to whom all thanks is due. Today, I want to share with you a moment in the life of Christ when he paused to offer thanks to God. And we want to discover what inspired his thankfulness and praise. What was it that Jesus was thankful for, and how might we also be inspired and thankful for the same thing in our own lives? If we turn to Matthew chapter 11, there in verse 25, Scripture says, "At that time, Jesus said, 'I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and intelligent and revealed them to infants.'" Now, when Scripture says here, at that time, it suggests that whatever was going on, Jesus paused and he reflected and gave thanks in light of what was happening at that time. And what is going on in the life of Christ that inspires him to reflection and thankfulness is a whole lot of frustration and failure. How can frustration and failure lead to a thankful heart? Well, as we see, Jesus sees things from the perspective of heaven and not the perspective of earth. If we go back just a few verses in Matthew chapter 11, we see what's going on at that time that Jesus offers thanks. In verse 20, Scripture says, "Then he proceeded to denounce the towns where most of his miracles were done because they did not repent. 'Woe to you, Chorazin! Woe to you, Bethsaida! For if the miracles that were done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented in sackcloth and ashes long ago. But I tell you, it will be more tolerable for Tyre and Sidon on the day of judgment than for you. And you, Capernaum, will you be exalted to heaven? No, you will go down to Hades. For if the miracles that were done in you had been done in Sodom, it would have remained until today. But I tell you, it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom on the day of judgment than for you. Now, these cities that Jesus is condemning, these woes to Chorazin and Bethsaida and Capernaum, these cities were the primary cities in which Jesus was doing ministry up until this point. And he's saying they've all failed to respond to the gospel, essentially. By and large, these cities have rejected the message of Jesus Christ. And that's the context. That's the moment. That's the place. That's the time that Jesus stops and offers thanks. He offers thanks when he's most frustrated and when he is at the lowest point. That's when he turns to God and offers thanks. I wonder if we could learn something from that. Are we thankful even when things are not going the way that we wish they were? Are we thankful when we don't get what we want? Are we thankful when we work so hard and nothing seems to come to fruition? Well, Jesus, he's thankful, and he offers his thanks to God the Father, because God is the one who can hear and know and understand in those situations. Now, it's interesting, these cities rejected him, but not all of them, right? Jesus had 12 disciples and many others. While the many had rejected Jesus, there were some who had accepted him. The poor, the peasants, the nobodies. Those were the ones who accepted Jesus. Not the many, but the few. Jesus says in Matthew chapter 22, there in verse 13, many are invited, but few are chosen. Many are invited, but few are chosen. And again, in Matthew chapter 7, verse 13 and 14, Jesus says, enter through the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the road broad that leads to destruction, and there are many who go through it. How narrow is the gate and difficult the road that leads to life, and few find it. Now, Jesus is not putting a privilege or premium on being in the minority or being among the few. It's nothing to say, well, I must be on the right path because I'm going against the grain. He's not suggesting that, but rather he's suggesting that on the whole, most people are not going to respond to the gospel. Most people are not going to find that way that leads to life because the other way is so much easier. It's the broad way. And of course, when Jesus preached to those cities in Galilee, most of the people rejected the message of Jesus. So he says in Matthew chapter 11, verse 25, at that time, Jesus said, I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth. Some translations render the Greek word here in the Christian Standard Bible as praise. They render it as thank. I thank instead of I praise. For example, the English Standard Version translates it this way. At that time, Jesus declared, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth. So we want to give thanks the way that Jesus does. And we want to note the connection between being thankful and praising God. To acknowledge who God is And to, at the same time, recognize that we're not just completely a puff of smoke at that point should inspire thankfulness. The Almighty, all-powerful, the God who is the creator among his creation ought to be praised, and thankfulness ought to be our constant disposition toward him. And so Jesus directs his praise and thanks to the Father, Lord of heaven and earth. No matter what we're going through, no matter what situation we might be in, if God is Lord of heaven and earth, we can be thankful. We can be thankful. Like Jesus, we ought to give thanks to the Father. Ephesians 5, verse 20, Paul says, giving thanks always for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. This is how we are, in Ephesians 5, filled with the Spirit. You want to be a Spirit-filled Christian? Start by giving thanks for everything to God the Father. Give thanks. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 18, again, Paul says, give thanks in everything or in every situation, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. You want to do God's will in your life? Start by giving thanks, no matter what your situation is. You find it hard to live a Christian life? Start by shifting the disposition of your heart to gratitude and thankfulness, and then you will find it easier. You will find it come into alignment with God's will. As Psalm 103, verse 2 says, my soul, bless the Lord, and do not forget all his benefits. You remember the old Christian song, count your many blessings. Name them one by one. Count your many blessings. See what God has done. When we ground ourselves in the Lord of heaven and earth, we begin to turn toward thankfulness and praise. The next thing Jesus says that he's thankful for is that God has hidden these things from the wise and intelligent. Again, Matthew 11, verse 25, he says, because you have hidden these things from the wise and intelligent, I praise you. Now, why would Jesus be praising and thanking God for people not being able to see the truth? Why would that be something he'd be thankful for? Well, Paul discusses this in his letter to the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians chapter 1. And Paul talks about how worldly wisdom gets in the way and serves as a barrier to the message of Jesus. In 1 Corinthians 1, beginning there in verse 18, Paul writes, for the word of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but it is the power of God to us who are being saved. For it is written, and he quotes from the prophet Isaiah, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and I will set aside the intelligence of the intelligent. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the teacher of the law? Where is the debater of this age? Hasn't God made the world's wisdom foolish? For since in God's wisdom, the world did not know God through wisdom, God was pleased to save those who believe through the foolishness of what is preached. Now, I want to pause there for a second because Paul gets a little wordy sometimes. He says, since in God's wisdom, the world did not know God through wisdom. He's comparing divine wisdom and human wisdom. And he says, in God's wisdom, things are set up so that human wisdom will not allow you to know him. It'll only take you so far. You can know that God exists. You can know that we're creatures. There must be a creator. All of that is apparent Paul says in Romans 1, just look at the creation. You can know there had to be a creator. But to know him and to know him in a saving way, for sure, human wisdom only goes so far. And so divine wisdom says, I'm going to make it so that you can't come to me with your own wisdom. In God's wisdom, the world did not know God through wisdom. God was pleased to save those who believe, not through human wisdom, but through the foolishness of what is preached. And then he explains, verse 22, for the Jews ask for signs, and the Greeks seek wisdom, human wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to the Jews and foolishness to the Gentiles. Yet to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God, because God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. We sang today that old song, Give Thanks with a Grateful Heart. Why? Because when I'm weak, he's strong. When I think that I'm poor, I realize that I'm rich in Christ. The wisdom of the world doesn't have a calculus that makes sense of that. The wisdom of the world says, if you're weak, you're weak. If you're poor, you're poor, and maybe you deserve it. But in divine wisdom, we find the weak are made strong and the poor are made rich in the things that really matter, not earthly things, but the spiritual things, the things that are rooted in Christ and him crucified. The greatest challenge of the modern world is not the inflated economy, but the inflated sense of worldly wisdom. Scott Peck wrote that book, The Road Less Traveled, but he also described what he called stages of spiritual growth in these terms. He says, as a child, you don't know. You don't know what you don't know. Right? You don't know the stove is hot. You don't know you shouldn't play in the street. As a teenager, you think you know what you don't know. And then as a young adult, you know what you know. But as a mature, wise adult, you know that you really don't know. In other words, as Proverbs 9, verse 10 says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. When we profess to be wise, Scripture says we become fools. In Romans chapter 1, verse 21 through 25, Paul says, for though they knew God, they did not glorify him as God or show gratitude. Instead, their thinking became worthless, and their senseless hearts were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal man, birds, four-footed animals, and reptiles. Therefore, God delivered them over in the desires of their hearts to sexual impurity, so that their bodies were degraded among themselves. They exchanged the truth of God for a lie, and worshiped and served what has been created instead of the Creator, who is praised forever. Amen. What is Paul talking about? He's talking about the road from true worship of the one true and living God to idolatry and worship of false gods. Where does it begin? It begins when they did not give thanks. They did not show gratitude to the Creator. Professing to be wise, they became fools. Now, Jesus says, I praise God that you have hidden these things from the wise and intelligent, but you have revealed them to infants. Again, there in Matthew 11, verse 25. But in Matthew 18, Jesus expands on this idea. In Matthew 18, verse 1, he says, at that time, the disciples came to Jesus and said, so who is greatest in the kingdom of heaven? And he called a small child and had him stand among them. Truly, I tell you, he said, unless you turn and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, whoever humbles himself like this child, this one who is greatest, this one is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. What is Jesus saying, that we all need to become pure and innocent like children? No, that's not what he's talking about. If you ever met a child, you know that's kind of an impossibility. What is he saying? He's saying we need to become humble like a child. We need to humble ourselves intellectually, humble ourselves in relationship to God, trusting him above ourselves and others. When Jesus says, I thank God, I praise him that you've hidden these things to the wise and intelligent, but you've revealed them to infants, to children, to babes. The idea here is that God is hiding the truth from some and revealing it to others. And that might suggest some sort of capriciousness or some sort of unfairness on God's part. But the language here reflects God's sovereignty, the idea that God is ruler over all. And God's sovereignty works in such a way to accomplish God's will without removing our free will and moral responsibility. Jesus said the issue here was about whether or not one has ears to hear. Listen to what Jesus says in Matthew chapter 13, beginning there in verse 10. He says, then the disciples came and asked him, why are you speaking to them in parables? He answered, because the secrets of the kingdom of heaven have been given for you to know, but it has not been given to them. For whoever has, more will be given to him, and he will have more than enough. But whoever does not have, even what he has will be taken away from him. That is why I speak to them in parables, because looking they do not see, and hearing they do not listen or understand. Isaiah's prophecy is fulfilled in them, which says, you will listen and listen, but never understand. You will look and look, but never perceive. For this people's heart has grown callous. Their ears are hard of hearing, and they have shut their eyes. Otherwise, they might see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their hearts and turn back, and I would heal them. Blessed, verse 16, Jesus says, blessed are your eyes because they do see, and your ears because they do hear. For truly I tell you, many prophets and righteous people longed to see the things you see, but didn't see them, to hear the things you hear, but didn't hear them. You see, this is God's will, that those who have a humbleness like a child, who have ears to hear, who have hearts that are open and warm to the truth, that are seeking God and his righteousness, they already have something that those who have stopped their ears and shut their eyes and hardened their hearts do not have. And because they have that beginning of wisdom, that fear of the Lord, the humility, they're going to get more and more as a result of that. This is God's will, that only the humble will be able to hear the truth. Again, Jesus says, I thank and praise the Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and intelligent and revealed them to infants. And then in verse 26 of Matthew 11, the next verse, he says, yes, Father, because this was your good pleasure. Right? Remember, it pleased God that in human wisdom, they couldn't know God, but only through the preaching of foolishness or the preaching of Christ and him crucified. This is God's plan. It is a way of arranging things so that those who really want to know the Lord and are able to humble themselves and seek Him are the only ones who are going to hear the truth and respond to it. It's an amazing, amazing challenge. As we approach Thanksgiving Day, let us humble ourselves and yield our human and worldly wisdom to the divine wisdom that sent us a suffering Savior and a crucified Christ. Let us set aside our opinions and think so's and hold on to what God has revealed to us. If there's anything to be thankful for this Thanksgiving Day, it is this. We have not been left here alone as orphans, condemned to walk aimlessly about in the dark by the light of our own wisdom. Perhaps you showed up here today a little bit lost, wandering in your life and wondering, what should I do? Where should I go? Or what is the point of doing or going anywhere? If that's the case, then I want you to turn to God in a thankful heart and reorient yourself to have ears that are open, eyes that can see, and a heart that is tender. In John chapter 14, the Lord Jesus spoke to his disciples, beginning there in verse 15, he says, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor to be with you forever. He is the Spirit of truth. The world is unable to receive him because it doesn't see him or know him. But you do know him because he remains with you and will be in you." The Father, he says, "I will not leave you as orphans. I am coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me because I live. You will live too. On that day, you will know that I am in my Father, you are in me, and I am in you. The one who has my commands and keeps them is the one who loves me, and the one who loves me will be loved by my Father. I also will love him and reveal myself to him." Jesus is thankful, even in the face of frustration and failure among the Galilean cities who by and large rejected the gospel. He's thankful that God's plan of redemption is going just as planned, going just according to plan, that only those who are truly seeking God with a humble heart and a thankful heart, only they can see the truth. It is revealed to them and hidden to others, but revealed to them. What does this mean? Well, on the one side, it means there's a great warning of hardening our hearts and not being able to seek God's truth because we're depending on our own human wisdom. We're not seeking answers in God's word, but we're seeking answers elsewhere. That's a warning. But on the other hand, it's a great invitation. It's an amazing notion that Jesus is saying the gospel is not just for the wise and intelligent, not just for the elite, the wealthy, the strong, the special, but it's for everyone. In fact, the most humble of all people may receive the good news in Jesus Christ. At the end of Matthew chapter 11, beginning there, verse 28, I don't know if we have this on the screen, but I'll read it to you. It says, "Come to me," Jesus says, "all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, because I am lowly and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." The good news is that God has revealed he has revealed to infants the things of Jesus Christ. And if we would humble ourselves like a little child, then we can be part of that amazing kingdom Jesus has offered us to receive and to enter in. All we have to do is accept that invitation. And it's a lot easier than going your own way, carrying those burdens on your own, trying to figure everything out on your own. That's the hard way. It's a lot easier to humble ourselves and take the yoke of Christ upon us. Paradoxically, there's a challenge in serving the Lord. In one place, Jesus says it's hard and difficult, it's the narrow way. But now here in Matthew 11, he says, if you don't want to be burdened all your life, follow me. I think what makes sense of that paradox is something that I remember a ministry mentor used to tell me to say to folks when we didn't know what else to say. He'd look at them and he'd say, you know, I don't know what you're going through. I'm not sure how this is all going to work out, but I know it'll be a lot easier with the Lord. So Jesus has come to me, all you are heavy laden and burdened, and I will give you rest. I'm thankful that God has not kept the gospel just for the special people, because I'm sure I wouldn't be in that group. I'm thankful that God has revealed it to infants, to those of us who don't really know what we're doing, that don't have all the answers. We can trust in Jesus and know that he will lead us to life. Let's pray together. Gracious God, our Father, we do praise you and thank you for all that you are, for all that you've done for us in Christ Jesus. Help us, Father God, to humble ourselves intellectually, that we would trust in your wisdom and not the world's wisdom, that we'd seek answers for our life and for eternal life in your word, what you've revealed to us. And we pray, Father, that you would help us to maintain a disposition of gratitude and thankfulness in all circumstances, in everything, knowing that you are the Lord of heaven and earth. And may we be so thankful that you've hidden the gospel from those who will not hear it because of their wisdom, but you've revealed it to those humble like children who will simply trust and obey. We're thankful, Father, because it makes the way to you so much easier, so much clearer. We thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.